Bound.
Hi everyone, welcome back to Books and Beyond. So today we are very happy to explore the Deccan, a lesser known region of India, and an era spanning 500 years with none other than Anirudh Kanisetti, whose debut book, Lord of the Deccan, has won the Sahitya Academy Yuva Puraskar Award and the Tata Lit Live Book of the Year Award. And it's also being adapted into a Sony Live web series. So I'm very excited because I'm a history buff and I love exploring lesser known periods of history.
Yes, and I think all these accolades that you mentioned, Tara, they are very well deserved because I haven't come across a book like this which covers the history of South India especially. And because I'm a South Indian, I've always been curious about the history and I didn't see it anywhere, you know. So we actually get to witness battles with the Chalukyas, Rashtrakutas, Cholas, you know, from the 6th century to the 12th century in all its splendor, right? It's, you know, this world where there are elephants who are being used for warfare. There's this, you know, rise and fall of the great cities and even how, you know, just basic everyday rituals of the kings, right? What do they do? Like all of these strategic decisions that they take to sort of, you know, be the most powerful king in that era, right? So actually Anirudh breathes life into these forgotten figures, you know, who have not been covered in our stories of kings and queens before, and his attempt to rewrite history of, you know, actual everyday people.
So the book covers, you know, politics, conflicts, losses. And one of the most interesting things is that these dynasties and this period of time hasn't been covered much before, but it's actually made India what it is today, right? From the way that we look at, you know, the architecture to language to religion to temples. And so that's what we're going to explore today with the author himself. And this is medieval South India come to life. So let's not waste any more time. Let's go back in time and let's enter the Deccan era with Anirudh. Welcome, Anirudh.
Welcome.
Thank you both. Thank you both so much for having me. And thank you for that wonderful, wonderful introduction. It's the strangest thing that I always feel as an author, and I don't think I'll ever get used to it, is to hear people talking about my own work and to really see that they are beginning to see the world through my own eyes, because writing a book is such a personal process. I think it brings out so much of who you are and so much of the way that you see the world around you. And when Michelle said that as a South Indian, she's always been curious about her own history, that's really why I wrote the book. As a South Indian who wanted to not just learn about my own past, but also really talk about it. So it just feels so gratifying to hear both of you talk about it, to know that you both have read it. And thank you so much for taking the time and for inviting me to this podcast.
Thank you. It's a pleasure, Anirudh. And, you know, like, you know, when we discuss South India, you know, obviously, like, even when we say North India, South India, all of that, it's still quite a very stereotypical image in our head, right? Because South India is rich. It has so many places, right, to cover. And you have not only covered the different places, but in fact, you've covered history, which spans over 500 years, right? And so the book is actually divided into three parts. And I find that very interesting because in the first part, you get to witness the Chalukyas' journey, right? You know, because they went to war with the north, with the south, with the east-west, you know. And in fact, they've even established the most oldest surviving temples that we have in the subcontinent, right? Then the second part actually covers the Vallabha emperors of the Deccan, right? And they are known as the Rashtrakutas, you know, and they actually vouched for Kannada, which is very interesting, you know, because their poets actually posed a very serious threat to literary Sanskrit, which was actually the most dominant language back then. And the third part actually talks to us about the Cholas, you know, like how they came to power when the Chalukyas and the Rashtrakutas sort of, you know, didn't make it, right? So I want to know, out of all the, you know, all the reigning powers in South India, why did you pick these three dynasties to explore the history of South India?
I think that in general, as you said, Michelle, we don't really understand the scale of South India and how large it actually is. And I think there's a general tendency, and I think I can say this with some confidence because I'm in Delhi, there's a tendency to conflate, at least from the North Indian point of view, to conflate South India specifically with Tamil Nadu and Tamil Nadu specifically with Chennai. But the reality is that South India is larger. It's about the size of Western Europe. It's an enormous place. Kerala's coastline is almost the length of Portugal's. And it goes without saying that all these regions have had tremendously rich histories, and surely as a result of the their scale, they have influenced not just each other but also the overall trajectory of India's history. And when I was thinking about what kind of book I wanted to write, it was very clear to me that I wanted to write a history that was connected to my own, something that was something that wasn't generally known about, wasn't generally written about. But beyond all these grand ambitions and principles, the most fundamental reason why it happened was an accidental question asked at a bookstore. Soon after I moved to Bangalore in 2017, I walked into Bookworm bookstore, this wonderful place on Church Street, and I asked them if they had any books about the history of Karnataka in English, and they did not. And I was just flabbergasted that such a well-regarded bookstore, and it's not that, you know, it's not that they weren't interested in Kannada history or they didn't want to write about Karnataka's history, it's just that nobody in the English language world was actually exploring this period and writing about it with the kind of critical attention and nuance that it deserved. And very soon after that, I happened to get talking with Manu Pillai, who at the time was working on his Rebel Sultans. And I think really with that opened the gateway and really proved that there is a demand for well-written, well-researched South Indian histories. And so that's really where the whole project of the book began. I wasn't necessarily sure I wanted to write about these particular dynasties, but then as I began to like really learn about them and really understand the remarkable things that they did, it became clearer and clearer to me that they had to be front and center in the book. And I must say, though, as far as the last third is concerned, yes, it is to an extent about the Cholas, but it is a Deccan perspective on the Cholas, because I think once again, the Cholas are reduced to a very particular set of achievements that they had that kind of suit, I think, our need for a particular kind of national pride today. So one very often talks about the Chola expeditions to Southeast Asia, but what they were doing within the subcontinent itself, and especially within the Deccan, is just generally not very well understood, and also brings out, I think, a very different aspect of the Cholas, because it encourages us to think about Chola militarism and more broadly about medieval militarism, because there is a tendency to see medieval kings as these extraordinary romantic heroes, which I can understand where that perspective comes from, but I think that as a democracy today, we should be less in awe of autocrats. And autocrats who were certainly charismatic, who had a very refined aesthetic language of power, to be certain, but still at the end of the day, men who believed they had absolute power over human lives. And as a result of that, committed horrific atrocities, which would, if they were alive today, earn them criticism from all and sundry. But just because they happen to be medieval kings, they tend to be seen rather as nationalist figureheads. And what I wanted to really do through the book was to complicate this picture and to ask questions about power, not just in the present day, because we once again see this kind of resurgence of politicians who present themselves as manly men who deserve military and autocratic power, but also to really question the way that we think about the past and the way that we think about power in the past and the way that power emerges with the Chalukyas, the way it matures under the Rashtrakutas, and the way that it eventually turns upon itself and collapses under its own contradictions under the later Western Chalukyas or the Kalyana Chalukyas. So that really was the way that I thought about the book and the ideas that I wanted to explore through.
Yeah, what I really liked about the book is that, it's a history of religion, it's a history of art, architecture, it's a history of everyday people, and the characters really come alive. And it's quite a big feat that you've covered all of this sort of, you know, in one book. But what I want to ask is, you mentioned that there's something wrong with our history lessons. And I think as, you know, millennials, this is something that Michelle and I discuss all the time, right? For example, we never taught anything that happens after the independence. There's whole stretches of time that were not focused on, right? We all only talked about sort of Mughals and then the Indian independence movement, and that too from a certain point of view. And nowadays there are lots that are coming out, like Ira Mukherjee's Daughters of the Sun, that are exploring facets that we may not have otherwise been exposed to. So why do you think that our history lessons have been skewed so much? And how do you, how is your book trying to address that and correct that?
So I think that fundamentally the way that we think about history as a school subject needs to be reassessed. I think there has been a tendency to see history as a tool to inculcate a national spirit, to inculcate a national identity. But I think that's a very reductive way of seeing the past, because I think that to reduce the lives of millions and millions of people across thousands of years to what lessons can I teach school kids about this king who lived in this year and built trees, planted mango trees on this highway, is ridiculously reductive. History does not exist to confirm our biases. It exists to challenge them. Just as the world that we live in is constantly frustrating and chaotic and has so much going on that constantly makes us reappraise the way that we see things and complicates the way that we understand things, that's what history is also meant to do. I think the purpose of history is not to say that India has always been a single country, but rather to show that the emergence of the modern Indian nation state was an extraordinary historical process that involved the interactions, both violent and peaceful, between so many regions, both within and outside the present-day boundaries of India. And that together, through a number of very complex factors and through all kinds of glories and tragedies, led to this extraordinary nation state that we live in today. And I think to really think about and approach history from that point of view, that looks at history's imperfections, that encourages us to think long term about how societies change, how polities change, how power represents itself, and what power can cause when it's not restricted, I think will make us not just more historically aware, but also make us better citizens by helping us understand the way that India has become the way it has come to be, and also the dangers and pitfalls of particular ways of thinking, not just about the past, but also about the present. So as much as I believe that representation is important, and I think that we should really move the curriculum into a more varied understanding of our past that isn't necessarily confined to particular imperial centers, I think it's also very important to understand that this task of representation must not be a political project to achieve a particular kind of goal beyond simply creating better informed or more critically thinking citizens. I think that this applies not just to history, but also more generally to the way that we think about education in India, is that education is seen as essentially steps that you take to get a particular kind of certification to get you a job. But education is meant to be much more than that. Education is meant not to create workers for IT parks, but rather to create intelligent, empathetic, well-informed young people. And I think approaching history from that perspective is much more respectful, not just to the past, but also to the present and to the future.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, like you said, you know, it's education is looked at as a means to an end. Whereas the funniest part is most of the stuff that I studied in maths, I don't use it today, right? So it's funny because what seems to be, you know, a part of our curriculum is also like, okay, like, you know, that sort of envision that we will use it in later life, but we often don't end up. So yes, I do feel that we need to rethink the kind of, you know, lessons that we sort of learn. And you've also mentioned that it's so problematic, especially our history lessons are so problematic that it's almost like ignoring the history of France or Germany when you're telling the history of Europe. Like, can someone even imagine that, right? No, but yet in India, we have a very skewed view. Anyway, so, you know, I mean, see, the book is right here with me, you know, for everyone who can say it's quite a thick book. It's a lot. I mean, yes, I can understand because you're covering, you know, 500 years over here. But because you want to provide a nuanced view, right, Anirudh, I was very curious as to why did you decide to sort of condense this entire period in one book? And in fact, why not have it like a series? Maybe, you know, one book on the Chalukyas, the other one on Rashtrakutas, others on Cholas. Like, how were you able to sort of provide the nuances that you had in one narrative?
Well, to be perfectly frank, I wasn't sure if people would read a second book. So I thought I might as well squeeze as much of it as I could into the first one. But also more generally, because as you said, Michelle, it's like ignoring 500 years of Germany's history, which is like it's an enormous chunk of the past where so many important things happened, and it's just willy-nilly discarded or seen as irrelevant to a particular kind of historical education. And it's an enormous gap that leads to so many misconceptions of India's past. Like, I remember when talking to a few folks about the basic idea for the book, a lot of people were taken aback that most of India's temples were built from 600 to 1100, which is actually fairly recent. We very often labor under the misconception that religion is some kind of unchanging eternal thing in India, rather than something that is innovative and that constantly responds to society, responds to politics, and that these temples that we see are not just these kind of religious sites that have existed from time immemorial, but areas that have been transformed through deliberate human action. That's just one example of it, of course, but the broader point that I'm trying to make is that given that this period could help clarify so many misconceptions, given that it could slot itself into what I think is a very significant and very major gap in understanding of the past, I knew that I would not be able to do justice to these remarkable dynasties, even if I were to write an entire book over each of them. There's just simply so much that goes on in these periods that it is not possible to condense it all, even into three separate books. Given that it was always going to be, to some extent, a condensed narrative, I figured, why not try and cover the entire period, fit in that jigsaw puzzle, show people that this exists, and then dive into it in more detail. So in my second book, for example, I want to provide a new perspective on the Cholas that isn't just because, and I have received a fair bit of critique because a lot of people are very surprised the Cholas did fairly horrifying things, or at least claimed to have done very horrifying things in the Deccan. And I want to explain from a Chola perspective why all those things were seen to be necessary. And not just from a Chola perspective, but also really from a societal perspective. What was going on below the kings? What was going on within the temples? Who were the people who were designing and sculpting the spectacular bronzes that are the greatest legacy of medieval Tamil art? So the idea really, I think I have brought the general idea across, but just to give you a TLDR, it is that I thought that the entire period was something that people deserve to know about, and that it also allowed me to make the case that people should have a curiosity about this entire area, this entire chunk of our past.
Yeah, I think just what you said, you know, about people not knowing when these temples were built, a lot of the things that were happening in the period that you describe have impact on us today culturally. And we are just completely unaware, right? I mean, Michelle, you're a South Indian. I mean, you're completely unaware that the art that you're seeing, or maybe the temples you're visiting, or even the language, the evolution of the language, or even how, you know, we practice religion, you know, the building of the temples. And you mentioned in the book that Hinduism was not always sort of, you know, this idol worship, and people did not always congregate around temples. So even the things that we are doing currently today, they have their roots, you know, and it's a multi-layered past, and they have their roots. And some of those roots are in those 500 years. And that is, so I agree in that way, that is a missing piece of the puzzle that teaches us more about how, you know, people used to live back then, but also how we are living today and where our culture comes from today. I think that was very, you know, interesting part of the book for me. And another thing that I really liked in the book is the characters, you know, because you can't, I mean, we're people, and that's the first thing we relate to, right? And there are stories about, and I really like that you didn't want to give this one-dimensional view where, you know, you have a character that's good or evil, or is very contrived or plays a certain part in a historical narrative, but you wanted to give sort of a multidimensional view of them, how they live, their social norms, the cultural context of the time that may have prompted them to behave in this way that they were doing, the rituals that, you know, they had, and even things like backstabbing. And you have these universal plot themes that come across where, you know, there's a child emperor and there's a vassal and there's manipulative forces, and all of these universal themes also coming in. So I was wondering, you know, what was your favorite character, historical figure in the book, and could you maybe relate an anecdote for our listeners?
It's difficult to pick a single one, honestly. A lot of people have told me they really like Danti Durga Rashtrakuta because, once again, he seems to come from this like really messed up family background, and to a considerable extent, a lot of his career seems to be spent in kind of overcoming the ghosts of the past. And then at the moment of his ultimate triumph, he just dies. It's just a marvelous example of how history isn't this linear process and there's always random and shocking things that happen. But honestly, my personal favorite is Someshwara Chalukya, who is the primary character of the 8th and 9th chapters and also appears in the 10th. He must have been a very traumatized person. He spends almost his entire life in merciless warfare that continues to become more and more brutal. He starts off as a prince. His father is almost assassinated and killed in multiple battles. And then when he comes to the throne, his family life is no better because he spends his entire career trying to keep the Cholas at bay and actually succeeds to a considerable extent. But in the process of doing that, in the process of trying to keep his grip on power, he commits horrifying atrocities. He attacks the great city of Dhara, which is a great center of learning. He betrays his own allies on multiple occasions where he finds it convenient. And eventually, it all seems to come full circle for him when his, you know, when his protege and his son eventually go over to the Chola side. And he commits suicide. He commits a ritual suicide at the end of it all. Like, it just seems like such an unspeakably tragic and dark life. And he's so often overshadowed by his Chola contemporaries. But, I mean, it can't have been easy to constantly... I mean, can you imagine the determination of a person like that? Can you imagine what kind of grim character, the kind of sheer grit and willpower it needs to constantly be defeated like that, to see crowds of refugees, to see your cities burned, to have to betray those who you have nurtured for decades, and then finally to have it all come back to you? It's just, I mean, what a person. I really hope that the TV series someday gets around to addressing him. But yeah, let's see. I just find him so interesting.
I feel like we have so many potential Game of Thrones series in our history.
Absolutely.
And we don't need to be watching. We just need to sort of make those happen. But yeah, Michelle, what is your favorite character?
Oh, okay. So, in fact, you know, I really liked analyzing the different kinds of personalities that these emperors have, because, you know, it's almost like this game of masculinity, right? Like, who's going to kill more people than the other? So, you know, I've even given them titles. So there's one who's Vikramaditya I, you know, from the Chalukyas dynasty. I've named him the King Killer because he apparently killed a lot of kings. And then we also have, you know, the Rajadhiraja from the Chola dynasty. I call him the decapitator because he actually decapitates, you know, a king for the crown, you know, and his head and all of that. But my favorite, I would say, I think would be Amoghavarsha Rashtrakuta, because he was a bit different and he mostly used his intellect to sort of spread the word about the nuances of language, of you know, trade. In fact, the Arab visitors who visited him then even named him one of the four great kings of the world. And you know, what he did was he actually made Kannada sort of more prominent, right? He actually established a Kannada grammar in his court. And there is a script called the Kaviraja Margam, which was in fact the first text which established a relationship between Sanskrit and Kannada, which I found really fascinating. I mean, I wouldn't imagine an emperor would sort of think of language or culture in sort of this way. So I think that's my favorite. But what about you, Tara?
Yeah, I think that, you know, the king, I forgot the name of the king who basically was not didn't want to use physical power, but he wanted to sort of use his diplomacy. And I find that very interesting because, I mean, there was so much violence in the books, in the book. I mean, that was the reality of the time, right? And this one character was so refreshing because he sort of wanted to be sort of, you know, using more diplomacy and going against that violent narrative. So I think that one was very refreshing for me.
It's so interesting to see both of your perspectives. And I think Michelle is really onto something when she says that it's so unexpected to see like a medieval emperor in a time of that's profoundly violent, actually saying, oh, let's think about like grammar and language. And that's what I find so interesting about these individuals is that it actually is impossible to fit them into a single bracket. They aren't monstrous villains, though they do commit atrocities, and they aren't glorious heroes, even they do remarkable things. They're simultaneously people of extraordinary culture. It's just the kind of educations they receive and the way they're deeply inculcated into philosophy, into linguistics, into literary analysis, that sort of thing, and really understand how to use that for power. But at the same time are also your typical manly men who are like, you know, no, I killed more kings than this guy did. And like, I'm the manliest man. I burn more cities. I kill more people. I think it encapsulates very well the contradictions of power and the contradictions of wealth and privilege, because I think it is an eternal rule throughout human history that very often, even though we see violence and atrocities as something that the less wealthy tend to do, it is really the vast majority of wars without question are always committed by those who are the wealthiest and ostensibly the most educated, because those are also the folks who know best how to disguise power and how to legitimize conflict and also to profit from it. Which is a much more dark and scintillating understanding of power than I think the one that we've become accustomed to.
And I think this power struggle, you know, that we saw in your book with the rise of certain dynasties and getting more territory. I mean, this is something that we've seen across, you know, these are such universal themes, even though the particular cultural context and the particular languages and all of those are very specific. But these themes are so universal where, you know, these sort of like, you know, powerful men want to gain more control and that struggle, you know, and that ego battle, I think something that has always been there and it still continues till today. Okay, so one thing that I really loved about the book, because I'm very interested in how religion, the evolution of religion, and it's not just one static thing, right? There's so many factors that come into play. And what I really liked is that the book not only reads like the history of the Deccan, but also sort of reads like the history of religion in the Deccan and the way that religion has evolved over the years. And it was a period where religion was evolving a lot with, you know, Buddhism, which had a big influence in Andhra Pradesh, where you have the, you know, bhakti devotion to Shiva, that cult sort of coming into place. And it's very interesting because the emperors tried to use religion to manipulate the crowd the way they wanted. And, you know, one of the stories that I really liked is the way that the Chalukyas, they come from a very humble background, but they made a myth about their origin story to legitimize their rule and to establish themselves as, you know, coming from the divine. And then how they align themselves with this growing bhakti devotion to Shiva to then, you know, manipulate people. And then even, you know, the building of temples, because earlier Hinduism, you know, it was not so much about idol worship, but the building of temples for people to congregate and then use that congregation to propagate your message. I thought that was really fascinating. So could you tell us, you know, I think you're the better person to explain this to our listeners. How did these emperors sort of manipulate religion to establish more power for themselves in that period?
So one of the most remarkable things, I think, about the way that we see kings even today is that very often they have the title Deva in their names, and yet it never occurs to us that that is meant to establish a link with the gods themselves. This idea, this question of why do they call themselves Devi and Deva? Where does that come from? It doesn't really seem to pop into our minds. But the answer is, I think, as you put it quite elegantly, Tara, it lies in the urge of medieval royals to link themselves to the gods and to therefore present themselves as the companions of the divine. And I wasn't able to actually get into this in that much detail in my first book, but hopefully I will be able to do it in the second. The way that emperors presented their actions, and this is not just in temples, but also if you look at their land grants, if you look at the way they write these Sanskrit prashastis or eulogies, they really try to divinize themselves. The way they talk about destroying an enemy city effortlessly is very reminiscent of the myths of Shiva as Tripurantaka. And the way that they will talk about, you know, their conquests of women and love and so on, once again links them to the way that they saw their divine figures. So it is not just the way I'd like to put it is that temples and or really religion specifically in our world, we do have at least some conception that there is a separate secular life and then there is religious life. That was not the case in the medieval period. To them, religion was a fundamental aspect of the way that they saw the world and reality itself. So just as we understand science and manipulate the rules by performing particular kinds of rituals, they do manage to actually change the nature of reality. So that's why I spend a considerable amount of time in the first chapter talking about the Ashwamedha sacrifice. In the fifth chapter, I talk about the Hiranyagarbha, where Dantidurga Rashtrakuta immerses himself and emerges from a golden egg, symbolizing his cosmic rebirth. And of course, to us, I mean, or at least to me, it's a bit silly to think of a grown man crouching inside a little ball and coming out and claiming to suddenly have a cosmic body. But in reality, given that we don't know how Dantidurga, he hasn't left behind a journal or a diary, so to understand how he saw this, whether he was cynically manipulating this ritual because he knew that's what people wanted, or whether he genuinely believed that in the metaphysics that he was educated with, that this would actually lead to a particular kind of outcome. And that's another reason why kings go out of their way to build these extraordinary temples and just plow so much resources into building the biggest and the grandest temples, because they did see it as a pact they were making with the gods, who in a way are, if not their equals, then at least they saw themselves as agents of the divine, who were destined to establish cosmic order, defined, of course, through the subjugation of women, through the subjugation of enemies, through the establishment of particular ways of seeing society. But also, in a sense, we know by actually looking at medieval texts, especially the Shaiva Agamas, there was a very clear sense that if you build a temple to Shiva as, let's say, if you were to look at Rajaraja Chola, who builds a temple to Shiva as Rajarajeshwara, the scale of the temple that he was building is described in the Shiva in the Shaiva Agamas as granting the boon of allowing, you know, the donor, the man who constructs that temple, to then, you know, upon his death, to then live forever as not as the Shiva, but as a being akin to Shiva. So these men also saw themselves essentially as gods. Of course, they could bleed, of course, they could feel, of course, all those things could happen to them. But through the kinds of rituals that they were performing, through giving the kinds of gifts that they gave, they saw it essentially as a way to establish themselves as divine agents, and then eventually as, I don't want to use the term gods, but at least as akin to gods in a particular way. And I don't want to pass a judgment and say that this was because they were egotistical or megalomaniacal, though some of them may very well have been. We know very well the nature of power and what power does to people. But it may genuinely also have been the way that they saw their place in the world. I mean, if you were to look at the super rich of today, they have some very, very strange ideas about what the world owes them and what their place is in the world and how they should be memorialized after death. And of course, so did medieval people. I think it's very important to remember that these people aren't necessarily more gullible or more stupid than we are, nor are they more cynical or more egotistical than we are. If you were to go back into the medieval world, you would see people who looked exactly like you and who felt the same kinds of emotions, but just experienced the world in different ways because the culture within which they evolved was no less all-encompassing than ours. It provided them with a particular way of seeing and understanding and navigating the world. And eventually, 200 years from now, our descendants are going to look back on us and also say, what a bunch of weird people. Why were they hiring unpaid interns and then not calling it slavery? That's essentially what it is. And that is the nature of history. Right? At some point, everything that happened in the past is going to look strange and otherworldly to us. But it's supposed to be like that because if the past was actually exactly the same as the present, if somebody tells you the past is exactly the same as the present, they aren't being honest with you at all. The past is a very, very different place.
Yeah, totally. But in fact, Anirudh, what I liked is that, yes, while there were emperors who were, you know, egotistical, and yes, like you said, Deva, Devi, all of that, we also see another side where, for example, you know, because they were trading with the Arabs, right, they did allow a lot of Arabs to establish mosques, right? And in fact, we know that even Amoghavarsha hired Muslim officers, you know, sort of to you know, giving them, I would say, equal rights like the others, right? And you've even mentioned that there is a group called Bayasira, who's sort of like a descendants of West Asian fathers and Indian mothers, which I found very interesting, which sort of shows you that things were not that closed back then as well, right? But, you know, again, see, talking about, you know, all of the flaws, you know, that we had back in history, I do think that women have not been given enough space, right? We do know that, be it in religion, be it in history, it's always women who are on the side. And in fact, you've even mentioned that you found it really difficult to find information about the Chalukya queens, you know, be it Vijayama Devi or Lokma Devi, right? And then you also cover the women of the Antapuram, which is actually the harem, you know, in the palace, right? Which is a women's quarters. And they had a hierarchy which was as complex as you find in courts, right? And what happens there is literally there were women who were monitored by others where, you know, their fertile periods were being tracked. And it's just, it sounds really bizarre, but it was a thing of the day. And in fact, what was interesting is that only the most important, connected, you know, well-qualified women would be allowed the right to sort of, you know, take the generation further, you know. So I wanted to know more about, especially these women in that period, Anirudh. What were your observations? What were the roles that were sort of given to women back then?
I think the crucial thing to remember is that I don't think there has ever been a point in history where women have just been passive observers and victims, which is something that is really taking root in modern political discourse. And I completely and fundamentally disagree with it. I think that it is a tremendous injustice to historical women to assume that just because we can't see them in the historical record, that they weren't there. Like, one of the silliest things I've come across is this idea that like Bayasiras, for example, who are descended from West Asian fathers and Indian mothers, were more inclined towards their father's culture or their father's religion, and that their mothers were nothing more than receptacles for giving birth to them and feeding them, which is a ridiculous way of seeing things. Or anybody who genuinely believes that probably doesn't understand their mother very well, or doesn't understand their mother's role in raising them. Because, I mean, from the humblest family to the wealthiest and most powerful, this idea that women have always confined themselves to the roles that men have ordained for them is a massive oversimplification. It's simply not true. But at the same time, just because some women achieve positions of privilege does not mean that a society affords women an equal place in general. Just because India had a female prime minister well before many other democracies does not mean that India has solved its issues with patriarchy or misogyny. And it's the same thing with the medieval world as well. I very often come across these claims that oh, you know, this lady Gargi is mentioned in the Vedic period. She's mentioned in the Vedas and the Upanishads. Therefore, that is proof that Vedic society was feminist. Or especially in the medieval period, oh, here's this one queen who exercised power, and therefore she's proof that this society was progressive or feminist. And that's simply not the case. The reality of it is that I think when we think about feminism, especially when we think about feminist ideas in a medieval context, we have to be intersectional about it and understand that, yes, the privileged, irrespective of their gender or sexuality, will inevitably be able to use their connections to rise to positions which people with a similar sexual orientation, a similar gender, would not ever be able to even dream about. Just because I'm able to talk about Loka Mahadevi and Vijay Mahadevi does not mean that women in general were well off in the medieval period. And that's why I also take a lot of time to point to primary sources where kings talk about women in profoundly disturbing ways. Because I think that it is very important for us to understand how far we have come as a society from those times, but also to understand in a lot of ways how those attitudes actually still persist and require us to be aware of them. We must understand how far we have come, but also how far remains to go for us all. And also remember that women are not passive bystanders. They play an active and central role in shaping the past and the present and the future. And it is high time that us male historians do a little more than the bare minimum and acknowledge the role that women have played throughout time.
And out of all the women, you said that the resources were limited. But had you come across sort of any, you know, maybe you could narrate an anecdote or an interesting story about a woman leader that you found really fascinating?
Well, I really find the Rashtrakuta queen, Sheela Mahadevi, very interesting. I wasn't really able to get into her in a lot of detail in the book, partially because of the lack of sources and partially also because of narrative constraints, because as much as I wanted to talk about everybody in endless detail, I simply could not. From my calculations, I expect that it seems that she was much, much younger than her husband when she got married. Her husband had already been married before. He had two adult sons. But not only did she come from a foreign kingdom, she was able to once again rise to a fairly important status. And of course, this happened with other queens as well through the book. But to me, Sheela Mahadevi was particularly interesting because she came from the Vengi region in Andhra Pradesh, which incidentally is where some ancestors of mine were from. So to think of somebody who probably, even if very, very distantly, shared some kind of connection to me, and who I could really imagine, because if you were to look at the sculptures of Andhra in close detail, you would know that the kind of hairstyles that women there wore was slightly different from what women in the Deccan were wearing. And I just had this like dazzling kind of like image in my mind of this young girl who's accustomed to doing things and like having her hair arranged in a particular way, arriving at this alien court in a kingdom that has extorted her father and basically ambushing him into giving her as a bride. And then imagining her hair being bound in a different way now in the fashion of a Rashtrakuta court. And of course, I can never prove that this actually happened. I think logically it must have, but I can't prove that it happened. But it still just seemed, it just struck a very deep chord with me. It seemed to me that I could imagine this as a real living, breathing person going through difficulty and then knowing that eventually she overcame it and that her son became the Rashtrakuta emperor tells me that she must have been a person of great strength of character. And not just that, but if you were to actually, once again, I was not able to include this in great detail, but her grandsons, great-grandsons, her granddaughter eventually became a Sanskrit poet, and her descendants sat on thrones, not just in the Deccan, but also eventually in her homeland, as well as in a number of other places surrounding the Deccan. So in a way, this young girl ended up becoming the grandmother of many medieval Deccan kingdoms. And there is no way for us to reconstruct her life in any degree of detail. And it partially as a result of that, I think she really stayed with me.
Yeah, and just when you mentioned of the way she tied her hair and all of that, that was just taken back to all the descriptions in the book, right? Because you've not only covered the different, you know, kinds of warriors that were there, what tactics they use, kings, queens, arts, sculpture, you know, architecture, you've covered so much. In fact, I just love this description of how you mentioned how the Rashtrakutas look, right? For example, their wavy black hair, it was fastened with you know, vibrant cloth bands, which were tied around their foreheads. And in fact, they had bare chests, you know, draped in triple necklaces made of many colored beads. And in fact, their forearms, you know, up to the elbows, it was covered in iron bracelets, right? And their legs were covered in loincloth, which was tucked around their knees. And then they had a band around their waist, which held a dagger, right? Which is a very vivid description of how they dressed up. And yes, you have mentioned all these, I would say nuances for which we understand what was their culture like, right? But I also have this concern when I was reading the book, Anirudh, while yes, you know, every culture has these different sort of, you know, habits, the way we eat, the way we sort of, you know, dress, the way we interact and all of that. At the end of the day, reading about all of these kings and just the way they were trying to compete with each other, right, which shows a very typical male attitude. I want to know what, according to you, is the stark difference between the Mughals and the Guptas that we have been reading about all these years in our history books, versus these who are the Chalukyas, Cholas, Rashtrakutas, right? Like, I mean, yes, apart from cultural differences, do you really think there's a major difference between the North Indian warriors and the South Indian warriors? Because honestly, to me, at a point, I felt like they all are just bloodthirsty warriors, you know, fighting for power.
That's a really interesting question. I'm not really sure how to answer it. But I do think that your feeling is right, Michelle, in that, yeah, it is the nature of powerful men or just powerful people hasn't really changed. The tendency to see other people as less than them, the tendency to use violence to achieve your means, the tendency to see women as possessions to be bargained for, traded away, and this hunger for wealth, for luxury, presented in whatever terms, but that's essentially what it is. You can dress it up as philanthropy, you can support whatever charitable foundations, but at the end of the day, power, I think, and that's the strangest thing, is that wherever you look in human history, whichever culture you look at, powerful people just behave in very similar ways. And to me, the strangest thing as a historian writing on medieval autocrats is that you look at modern autocrats and you're like, I can see very clearly the hypocrisies like laid bare because they're doing the exact same things. But somehow I think humanity does not learn its lessons from history. The same trick works again unless people are aware and know that this is how power operates. And this really ties back to an earlier question I think Tara had asked about our curricula and the way we think about history. Because if we're really taught to understand the way that power presents itself, I think we would be much less credulous in the way that we are taken in by these charismatic military men. Because honestly, I think that the way that we think about the Mughals is a really great example of this. Because for many decades up till now, the Mughals were seen as these charismatic, glamorous people. And I think to a large extent, that has not really gone away. Like just, I think, last week, there was a massive auction of like Mughal art objects that sold for hundreds of thousands of pounds. Which is like fortunes that, you know, most Indians can't even conceive of, whether today or whether they were the subjects of the Mughals. But yes, yet this aura of glamour around them persists. And now there is a backlash to that, but rather the backlash is not about the fact that these were autocrats who committed horrible things in the name of power and justified horrible things in the name of power. Rather, the backlash is about the religion that they followed, which is just absurd, because it absolves all other kings who happened to be of a different religion but did the same kind of monstrous things. And the kings that I write about are a great example of that, in that yeah, they, just because they were Hindus or because they were Jains didn't doesn't mean that they were any less inclined to do the same things that the Mughals did, whether it was to women or whether it was in terms of manipulating religion to present themselves in particular ways, whether it was a taste for luxury objects or whether it was a taste for war at unprecedented scales. I think that the lesson that we should take away from all this is to be more wary of power rather than being wary of like particular religions, because I think the lesson that history teaches again and again is that it is not a particular culture, it is not a particular religion that makes powerful people do these things. It is power itself. And what we should be suspicious of as citizens of a democracy with ostensibly equal rights given to us by the Constitution is not to be wary of each other, but rather to be wary of those who rule us.
Yeah, very well put. And yeah, and that's the irony, right, Anirudh? Because even I've heard of that line that, you know, Mughals really looted us and, you know, what we were and what they ended up sort of making us. And now when you read this sort of, you know, your version of history, or when you read a more comprehensive version, you do understand that, no, but everyone did the same thing. All of them looted in their own ways, right? Everyone had their own strategies. And what I find really fascinating about this is, you know, even the war tactics, right? Even that has changed over the years. So one thing I know is that, you know, elephants are not used these days for war combats, and they used to be used back then. I really found that fascinating, but also it is problematic in a way, right? Because like you said, who's more powerful and who do they feel they can sort of use in a way, or who can they manipulate, you know, to sort of make the most of it, right? So you said that elephants sort of were the played the role of modern day tanks. Right. So they would unleash probably the hugest elephant that they have, you know, just to sort of release this shock value towards their enemies. Right. So could you please tell us what were the role of elephants back then? And of course, in today's day, it would be animal abuse. But, you know, do you know of any other fascinating war tactics that you came across?
So I happen to, just purely as an accident of the YouTube algorithm, a few years ago, I happened to watch a video of a temple elephant in Kerala just going into a rampage. And without exaggeration, one of the most terrifying things I've ever seen is just the way that such an enormous animal driven past its breaking point and the kind of damage it can do to a human. Like, just there was very little left of the person once the elephant was done with it. Like, the way that it moved its tusk, the way it like slammed him down, disemboweled him and then trampled him. And apologies to the audience for the graphic language, of course, but that's exactly the same kind of use that you see elephants being put to in medieval sculpture as well. Like, right down to say they're actually trained to fight in particular ways, to, you know, to throw enemies down or to like lift them with their trunks, to throw them around, to wield weapons even. And I think there's something so disturbing about an animal being trained to use a human weapon. It's just such a profound, I think, perversion of the natural order, and really makes you question once again this romanticized idea we have of medieval people as being in tune with nature and like all these things. The reality of it is that if medieval people had the technological ability to exploit nature, they absolutely would have. It's just that they weren't able to do it in the scale that we can, which ties back to an earlier point I was making about, you know, how we haven't fundamentally changed the species from then to now.
What I've found also very interesting, because I've been following you for a while, because I follow your podcast, Echoes of India, which is about Indian history. And I was very happy to see, you know, that you've written a book as well. So I wanted to shift tracks a little bit and ask you more about your journey from podcasting to now writing a book. What was your journey like? What is your journey towards getting published? And what medium do you prefer, book or podcast?
I think I prefer books, though of course they have their upsides and they have their downsides. I feel like with a podcast, there's a compulsion to like have, you need to have a neat little narrative package. You need to have a neat little package of sounds and so on. Everything needs to be condensed into these like 20-minute digestible chunks. But with a book, like, you can, like, the potential for storytelling is just so much grander, because you actually can, if you're able to pull it off, and if you have a good editor, very importantly, then you can actually give people a narrative of 500 years of history which is just not possible in a podcast, unless the podcast were like 15 hours long, in which case you'd lose people's attention after 15 minutes, after all the work that goes into. So I do think I prefer long form writing in general. In terms of the journey, well, honestly, I got into podcasting as a result of a bet, in a sense. I used to work for a think tank in Bangalore, and we used to have these weekly research meetings on Thursdays, where I used to just talk about history. And, you know, given that it was a public policy think tank, wasn't always received very well. I remember a few folks once jokingly said, "Hey, you know, why don't you create a history podcast called Jumping to Conclusions?" So I was like, ouch. But also, why not do a history podcast? Because the think tank did do podcasting. They had a tie-up with IBM Podcasts. And I did a bit of searching and found that there were no Indian history podcasts. There was like one done by, I think, Kit Patrick, who was at Azim Premji University at the time. But it didn't really, I think, scratch the itch that I felt that if I wanted to listen to a history podcast, what would I listen to? I was very, very, very lucky to have like a good set of producers at IBM when Echoes of India started off, because I think that they really understood what I was trying to do. You know, when I said, okay, so I've written this battle scene, and would you guys be able to make it sound like a battle? Can we put in like elephant trumpeting sounds, and can you put in like a conch shell and like all those things? And I said, yeah, we can absolutely do that. And I still remember, like, soon after Echoes of India's first season, I happened to meet someone who said that he was cutting vegetables when he was listening to the first episode. And at the point where, you know, the King Porus makes his last stand against Alexander, and he orders his bodyguards to like blow conch shells, and there were actual conch shells in an English language history podcast, he was so shocked he almost cut his finger. And I just, that moment really stayed with me, because I think it showed me the potential of storytelling with audio. And I think, honestly, one of the creative endeavors I'm most proud of, and I don't think I'll ever be able to capture that lightning in a bottle again, was, I think, one of the middle episodes of season 2 of Echoes of India, where I'm just walking through the medieval city of Ujjain and get like pulled into like a little bit of a prank slash gossipy scandal that's going on in the courtesans district. And I just had such a great time writing that, recording that with a couple of friends, and then going and getting drunk afterwards, and really feeling like I'm living up to the legacy of our ancient ancestors. Because I think that very down-to-earth and irreverent perspective of Indian history, where it's not just about great and glorious kings trying to teach you some tiresome moralizing lesson, which is what our history has been reduced to, but instead just making history about like people gossiping and doing silly things and pranking their friends, which is what life is actually like for most of us, rather than, oh, you know, Pradhan Mantri said this, so let us worship him and let us do this or that that the Pradhan Mantri has told us. That's not how we live our lives. That's not how historical people live their lives. So that was something I really enjoyed at Echoes, is that I could be a little, you know, I could be a little rude, I could be a little quirky and like poke fun at people in a way that you can't really do in nonfiction, because people expect you to be very serious with nonfiction. I remember my editor once told me that he's very glad that he removed a lot of the college humor and fart jokes from the first draft of Lords of the Deccan. It would have been a very different book, more entertaining perhaps, but definitely won't have sold as well, I think.
Thanks for that. And that's a very interesting journey. And I love how it happened, you know, just like very serendipitously. So really like stories like that, and now, you know, it's being made into a TV show and all of those things, so
yes,
that's really wonderful.
Unfortunately, minus all the fart jokes and college humor, which no, but I think, on TV.
But you know, I mean, in the book's defense, Anirudh, you know, it's not dry like our history textbooks, right? It does read like a thriller, because you want to know what happens next, who's going to overthrow the throne and all of that anyway. But yeah, I do like how you've mentioned that it's a collaborative process, right? Like, for example, if you write the script and someone else sort of adds the audio and all of that, and pretty much with your book as well, you know, I really love reading the acknowledgement section usually. And I like that you've acknowledged people like, you know, the bus conductor, for example, who advised you on the best bus routes, right? Sometimes it's the strangers that that are like sort of help us out when we don't know anyone, right? In a place when you're conducting research, or it could be the gentleman at the Mythic Society in Bengaluru, right? Who helped you sort of look up an out of print publication. And we do know that nonfiction, you know, relies on research. It relies on help from a lot of people. So I want to know, you know, especially the relationship that you had with your research assistant or scholar, who is Sartak Sharma. You know, do you have any anecdote that you'd like to share with us? Something funny that sort of, you know, happened while both of you were working on this?
Well, Sartak and I got to know each other through memes. So I think that that's one of the most important things to know about our dynamic. But like during the research process, I mean, it was just very amusing because like, I don't think either of us like fully understood the gravity of what was happening as the book was coming together. Sardha came in towards the ending of the process when we were like putting together maps and appendices and so on. And I was like, Sardha, look, my bibliography is in a complete mess. I don't know how to cite these things. Can you please help? And then in 2 days, he like magically fixed everything up. And I must say that making friends through memes is one of the unique gems of our contemporary culture. And I won't give it up for the world. In fact, for a while during the pandemic, I actually ran a historical meme page. And I keep meaning to get back to doing it, but I just never get around to it because long form writing is a massive, massive project. But I made so many good friends through just memes. And also, rather than seeing the act of writing and creating something as this action done by this heroic intellectual all by themselves, it's high time we understand that creation is always a community process. And the more people are involved in creating something, the richer it is as a result, the richer the author is as a result. I'm profoundly grateful to all the people who I've happened to meet and who've impacted me, who asked me a question at the right time, who told me something that sent me off on this whole kind of research spiral that made me want to put in a particular thing. Nothing that I create, nothing that any of us creates exists in isolation. And from our books to ourselves, we are always a tapestry of the people who touch us. And I think that's something that we should always seek to remember and acknowledge.
Yeah, and in fact, just to mention, so Anirudh, one reason why I look at the acknowledgements is sort of to see that, because I do know that, you know, as a writer, a lot of it, yes, while you're working in Solace, there are a lot of people which contribute to your journey. So I, in fact, look to it to see whether the author is gracious enough to give credit to others.
Well, I'm glad I passed that exam.
Yeah. So, okay. So I also want to know, you know, what made you interested in history in the first place? The story about, you know, working at the think tank and coming up with the historical facts. Very interesting. But yeah, was there any sort of anecdote from childhood or what got you interested?
Video games. It was video games and having too much time on my hands in college that really got me deeply into history. I mean, I was always interested in it. I was a very curious child. I was very lucky that the first few years of my education were actually in the US because my dad was working there. And my teachers encouraged me to read voraciously. And the US has this remarkable public library culture that I think is tragically dying out in India today. And that gave me an exposure to so many things. Like I love dinosaurs. I still love dinosaurs. I recently got like a Princeton Field Guide to Dinosaurs, and I'm so proud of myself for like maintaining that passion for all these years. So, I mean, I was vaguely interested in history, but I wasn't particularly taken by it. I think partially because like all of us, my history teachers in school tend to reduce it to like a list of dates and, you know, this king after that king, and this king planted mango trees and that king built wells, rather than like, you know, all the other stuff we've been talking about in this podcast. But it was in college where I didn't have an attendance requirement, and we had a great LAN network. So I ended up just playing a lot of games, and I ended up playing a lot of historical games. And most historical games are made by Europeans or by Americans for people in the West. So they're very West-focused, and they're very focused on Western history. But if you were to play a game where Alexander the Great features, and then you look up Alexander the Great, you'll find like 100 well-researched, well-written books about him, and you will learn so much about him. But I started to get curious about Alexander's, you know, the people who Alexander was conquering, and like, I want to know about them. So when I started searching for the Mauryas, for example, I just found like a handful of books, Charles Allen's work, Romila Thapar, Nainjot Lahiri, but these are very academic books and I enjoyed reading them, but most people I knew didn't. So I started experimenting with blogging. I started like just take these kind of dry academic tomes and then make them into interesting narratives. And I just found that I had a flair for it. And that led into podcasting and that led into writing. And it's all very serendipitous, but I am so glad that I happened to find it because I feel like I worked in IT, I worked in a think tank, I worked in public policy, I worked in geostrategy. I've moved numbers from one imaginary Excel sheet to another to make somebody in some part of the world richer. But the one thing that has really brought me the most profound creative joy and made me feel like I'm really giving back to society is talking about history. And I'm so lucky to have found that and to have received the opportunities and the platforms to actually pursue that.
Wow, that's really wonderful. And that's amazing. Video game. So that means that, you know, hopefully after the next book and the TV series, there's a video game also.
I can only dream.
Yeah. In fact, like, you know, whatever we consume, which made me think about it, like not just video games, movies or whatever stories, most of them are very colonial. And I think what you've done here is you've sort of given us an alternate history, which makes me very curious about, you know, your reading taste, whether there are any books which cover alternate history like yours does, you know, especially alternate history of India.
Of India, well, I always recommend this book to everyone who asks me this question. It's called Courtly Culture and Political Life in Early Medieval India by Dawood Ali. It is an academic work, but it is fascinating because more than anything else, it is really that book that made me realize just what a different world medieval people lived in. Like from their ethics to their aesthetics to their taste for luxury to their body language to the way they conducted themselves in private and in public. More than anything else, that book made me realize that, okay, this is a whole other world that very few people understand as much as is needed, and really convinced me to be that bridge between the academia and the public. Aside from that, just generally speaking, I tend to read a lot of natural history, and there's some really interesting, there's a new wave of history books coming out of the West that are like really, really fascinating. So there's one called Medieval Bodies by Jack Hartnell, which looks at art from medieval Europe and like tries to understand through that, how did they think about body parts? How did they think of the head? How did they think of the heart? And it's just such a weird and wacky world that simultaneously feels familiar. And that's exactly what I want in a history book. If a history book is telling me, if it's going to agree with my biases, with my preconceived notion, with this narrative of heroes and villains that our politicians have been force-feeding us for the last few decades, I'm going to be very suspicious of it. But a book that shows me a world that is like ours, but also very alien, that's going to get my interest immediately and I'll be hooked. Another fantastic work that I'm reading is Toby Wilkinson's Tutankhamun's Trumpet, which looks at 100 objects found in the tomb of Tutankhamun, the famous Egyptian pharaoh, but then uses them to create this kind of material history of ancient Egypt, which is just such a fascinating concept. And there's a brilliant line in the book where he says that there's a couple of silver trumpets that were discovered in the tomb, and he says that we will never again hear the music that these trumpets used to play. And I was like, damn. Yeah.
That's a really good line. It makes you really think. And I also really like natural sort of history books. So I have written down Medieval Bodies and I'm going to check that one out. Yeah. You know, the intermingling of history and science, I think, is such a fascinating topic.
Yes.
So what do you read, you know, besides history? We've spoken about, you know, a lot of history, but what do you read for fun besides history?
Oh, I've recently been really enjoying Abraham Verghese's The Covenant of Water.
Oh, yeah.
That's so much fun. Yeah,
It is just incredible. Because to an extent, it scratches the historical itch, but also by creating people who, once again, they're like us, but not exactly like us because they live in such a different world and they act like they belong to a different world. I don't want to like give spoilers to anybody who hasn't read it in the audience, but it is such an incredible testament to the development of medical knowledge and also to the ability of the human spirit to find joy and companionship even in what might seem to us to be dark and miserable times. Like, it's incredible. I just cannot recommend it enough.
I loved it so much, and I could not stop thinking about the ending. I don't want to give any spoilers, but
I'm still reading.
But what do you think?
I think it's one of the best generational family dramas that I've read in a long time. And anybody like who loves family dramas should read the book.
Well, I really like the line that you said that, you know, history is very interesting because there are people like us, but not like us. It's so similar to us, but also different. I think that is what makes it so fascinating, you know, because because we're all human at the end of the day. It's just, and we sort of imagine ourselves in that time period and what we would have done in that cultural context, because our biology, the way we think, the way we emote hasn't changed. And it's just the culture around us and the things around us that do. So anyway, that brings us to our second last section of the interview, which is our quiz round, which Michelle is our quiz master. So Michelle, take it ahead.
Yes, we call it the fun quiz. So I'm going to give you three options, Anirudh. You pick one, okay, for each question. All right. The first one is, apart from the Deccan, what is the other untapped history of India? A, Northeast. B, Union Territories. C, pre-partition India.
The Northeast, but I would also just say the East Coast, generally speaking. How many of us know about Odisha's history? And Odisha is an incredible place. What about Central India? Like, what about Chhattisgarh and Jharkhand? I mean, absolutely fascinating things went down in their history. Something that India's Adivasis, who we very often tend to dismiss, played a central role in. And yet we barely know about it. So there's like any number of like narratives waiting to be dug up.
Correct. Okay. The most fun part of working on the book, A, collating the pictures of the artwork, B, arranging the notes and bibliography section, C, speaking to Satak.
Okay. I mean, we already know it wasn't the notes and bibliography for sure. But yeah, getting together the images was actually a lot of fun because it happened at the very ending of the whole process, and I was like almost at the finish line, and like there was this looming satisfaction and ennui of like finally being done with the book. So that was an incredibly enjoying process.
Nice. Okay. One language that became popular in the Deccan era: A, Kannada; B, Sanskrit; C, Tamil.
Kannada.
One dynasty you wish you were a part of: A, Rashtrakutas; B, Cholas; C, Chalukyas.
I won't want to be part of any royal dynasty. I would not be able to survive the pressure and the stress. I would not want to grow up thinking everybody around me is going to betray me if they get a chance. So I have to respectfully say none of the above.
I guess that. Yeah. Okay. Awesome. So now this brings us to the last round of the podcast, which is the rapid fire round. So you get to answer in one word or one line and no thinking. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. One word that existed in the Deccan period that isn't used now.
Prithivi Vallabha.
What does that mean?
It means the beloved of the earth.
Oh, wow. Okay. One skill every historian must cultivate when recording alternate histories.
I would say independent thinking. As much as important to pay homage to earlier generations of scholars, we should always be careful and considered in forming our own opinions.
Nice. Okay, one temple that you wish existed till date?
Oh, I wish that the Bhojeshwara temple at Bhojpur was actually completed. It would have been the single tallest building of the medieval period. But unfortunately, the Chalukyas made sure that didn't happen.
One character from your book that you would like to meet in real life?
Oh, I would like to meet the nameless Thapati, the architect of the Kailashnatha temple, because that must have been one of the great geniuses of human history. Like, I don't think there have been a lot of people like that who could envision, imagine, and execute a project of that scale with that degree of confidence. Like, what a person. Like, he makes, you know, the Sistine Chapel look like a child's scribbles. You know, it's incredible to imagine. What he must have been an incredible person.
Awesome. Okay, one route that you wish a king hadn't taken in the Deccan.
That's actually a difficult one to answer because there's so many branching paths in history. I don't know. I guess I would say...
Yeah, like basically one thing you wish they hadn't done. Like, you know, any action or any route that they sort of took which you think they could change history.
Oh. See, this is not the right. This is not the kind of question to ask a historian because, like, I'm like, wait, this would have led to that, and that would.
There's a lot of permutation conversation. Okay.
I don't think I can answer that question.
All right.
Okay. Cool. What's next?
Like I said, a new social history of the Chola world, which really I think, for the first time, for a narrative nonfiction book, will take the focus away from the royal courts and deep into the countryside. The remarkable thing about medieval Tamil Nadu is that you have an enormous wealth of inscriptions from everybody from like shepherds and like washer people all the way up to kings and emperors. And that allows us to reconstruct over hundreds of years the rise of a militarized medieval autocracy, allows us to see how it shattered and transformed the society it was part of, and how eventually it collapsed and succumbed to its own contradictions. And very clearly how it left the world transformed in its wake. So that's something I'm super, super excited for. And that's going to hopefully come out next year.
We are excited as well. So this was a really interesting conversation, Anirudh, especially as a South Indian. Like I was saying, you know, we don't often come across enough stories about South India. And I think our conversation made your book come alive even more. It's like watching a movie. So thank you so much for being so generous with your answers. It was a lot of fun.
Thank you.
Thank you for your detailed questions and for reading the book so closely. It's always a pleasure to be able to like talk about all this stuff with people who are generally passionate about the art and craft of writing and reading. So thank you, and thank you to the audience for having me.